We've been talking about instant messaging and, you know, messaging apps. How can you start having the same conversations you might have over the internet, but when maybe someone's got their phone off, like, asynchronously? Right? You might have to wait 6 months before the next message comes. These are things we have to think about. That gives attackers a lot of time to break keys. It gives you a lot of time to forget what the key was, and then a message comes in and you can't read it. We've only covered half the story. Right? We've talked about this pre-key bundles and this initial triple Diffie-Hellman key exchange, which is where we want to asynchronously establish some keys. Right? Now, one option then would be to, just like on the internet, when you're doing online shopping, is to use that key from now on to secure every message. That is not a good idea, because imagine that you have a conversation for 6 months and some nefarious party has recorded all of your messages. Then what happens is you break one of them and you've got all of them, because all the keys are always the same, right? So we don't do that, we update the key. I guess there's a question of how often do you update the key? And Signal and WhatsApp and the Signal protocol are pretty rigid about this. They'll update the key every single message, right? Every single message when you use an app like this is a different key. Right. So basically make it as absolutely difficult as possible as an attacker to get any message. You break a message, maybe you read one message, maybe you get a couple if you're lucky, right? Because you're sniffing everything. But most of the time you'll get one and that's all. And of course the keys are not exactly easy to break anyway. Right? So it makes it very, very difficult to break. At the core of this is something called a ratchet function. Right? A ratchet function is a function that can sort of turn in one way, but not backwards. So think of it like a hash function. You can take an input, go through a hash function, but you can't go backwards. Right? So that's kind of like a ratchet. And the key derivation function that we use here, which is kind of like a hash, is used in this way. It's called a KDF ratchet, or key derivation function ratchet. So let's imagine that we have our root key, or our key, right? So this is our current key, and we want to encrypt a message. So what we do is we pass it through a key derivation function, which operates in a similar way in this instance to a hash, but they're a defined cryptographic primitive. It has an input that comes in here. This can be a constant, it could be relevant to whatever the application is, and out comes a new key and your current output key, or message key, or, you know, temporary key, whatever you want to call it, right? So this is a kind of chain. So this is message one that we encrypt using this key. Maybe we want to send another message. So we put this through the KDF again, KDF, not KDE, go through here. This comes out with another key and another message two key, right? And this goes on and on. And this kind of function is absolutely at the core of things like Signal, WhatsApp. The reason it's useful is because it doesn't let us turn backwards. If I break this key as an attacker, I can't reverse this one-way function to get to this key. So I can't find what this message key was, or this message key, or all the ones going back in time. So I can break a key somewhere in a conversation, and I can't read any of the message you wrote previously. That's a good thing. What it doesn't do is provide us with sort of future secrecy. So if I break this key, I can use this KDF to produce this key and this key, and so on and so forth. That's a huge problem. So how do we fix that? Well, what we tend to do is we bring in a Diffie-Hellman ratchet as well. So sometimes what will happen is, when they're having these conversations, is that you'll receive Diffie-Hellman parameters from the other party, and you'll use them to manipulate your key derivation function to change this chain. And that will mean that if someone cracked a key, as long as they're not privy to all the Diffie-Hellman parameters, you'll be able to re-establish secrecy from then on, right? So this is very nice. When we combine a KDF chain with this Diffie-Hellman ratchet, we've got this kind of double ratchet, and that's what happens in Signal and in WhatsApp. So let's have a look at how this actually works in practice. I'm going to simplify a bit by drawing these ratchets as sort of actual physical ratchets rather than keys and key pairs and things. Right, so we have our two classic parties that are having a conversation, Alice and Bob. Now, Alice has three KDF chains that she's using. One is a, drawing a ratchet is going to be difficult. So I'm going to draw them as circles with, you know.
That's my job then, right?
Yeah, that's your job, sorry. So Alice has a Diffie-Hellman ratchet here, right, which is sort of, you know, got these one-way things on it that mean it can't turn backwards, right? She has a sending ratchet, send, and a receiving ratchet, receive, right? And Bob has the exact same thing. So he has a Diffie-Hellman ratchet of his own, and he has a sending ratchet, and he has a receiving ratchet. Now, what's going to happen is every time that Alice wants to send a message to Bob, she's going to update this sending ratchet, produce a new output key, and send that to Bob. Right? So let's imagine that happens. Let's say Alice sends a message to Bob. So she ticks this ratchet over, she produces another key in that chain, and an output message key. So let's call this Alice1, right? Alice encrypts a message with Alice1 and sends it over to Bob. Bob ticks over his receiving chain. Luckily, the sending chain of Alice and the receiving chain of Bob started at the same point, so they know what they're doing, right? He ticks this over one and produces that same A1 so that he can decrypt the message and read it, right? So Alice maybe wants to send another one, so she's going to tick this KDF function again. She's going to produce a new key and A2, right? She's going to send that to Bob. He's going to tick this receiving function A2. Now, Bob wants to send a message, so he's going to tick his, this is going to be Bob1. Alice gets a message and thinks, well, that means I need to calculate whatever the key was to work out what that message was. So she's going to tick this and going to get B1 like this. And these chains are just going to theoretically grow and grow, right? And Alice's sending chain will be in sync with Bob's receiving chain and vice versa. Bob will send a message and it will be Alice's receiving chain that has the right key. So all that has to happen for this to work is that the sending and receiving chains for both Alice and Bob have to be in sync. And they have to start at the same position, right? But we know that's easy to do because they started using a Diffie-Hellman key exchange. But we haven't got that future secrecy that we wanted, right? These won't heal themselves. If someone breaks A2, right, and knows what this sending key was, they've essentially broken Alice's ratchet and they can tick along with it and work out all of these messages. So what happens occasionally, or whenever they want, is as part of one of Bob's messages, he will send a new Diffie-Hellman public key. So this will come over here like this. Alice will use it to tick her Diffie-Hellman ratchet, and that will reset these messages, right? And Bob will also do the same thing. He will reset his sending or receiving messages as appropriate. This Diffie-Hellman parameter is used to update the starting positions of these two ratchets, and then they continue with their messages.
Presumably Bob's update the moment he sends a Diffie-Hellman.
That's right. So he will have already done that, so that he can then send B1 using the latest Diffie-Hellman pair. So they can send these every message if they want, or hardly ever. In practice, it's sent every message. Right. So the idea is that we have loads of really interesting cryptographic properties here. First of all, the Diffie-Hellman means that we have a sort of self-healing property, right? If someone breaks one of these intermediate keys, as soon as one of these Diffie-Hellman ratchets ticks over, that gets reset and we lose that ability. Because of these KDF ratchets, if you break one of these keys down here, you can't find out what all the other messages were. This method of producing keys will kind of heal itself and you can't reverse it. You can't go back down the chain and decrypt historic messages. And it also deals nicely with asynchronous data. Alice can send 10 messages to Bob, right, with or without Diffie-Hellman parameters, and as long as they both follow the rules, the exact right amount of keys will be generated and they will exactly match his receiving keys. Right? And they can update their Diffie-Hellman parameters as well whenever they want.
Does the Diffie-Hellman go one way? Is it only ever Bob to Alice?
No, so remember that Diffie-Hellman is a conversation between two parties. They both have a public key. So every time Alice sends a message, she'll send her part, and every time Bob sends a message, he'll send his part. So essentially you have these sort of halfway Diffie-Hellman exchanges, which is this ratchet. So Alice will send and they'll both update. Bob will send and they'll both update. Alice will send and they'll both update. So keeping these different chains in sync is a little bit of a brain melter, right? But it can be done as long as you follow the rules and as long as Alice and Bob are doing the exact same thing, you'll find that they know exactly which key handles which message.
What happens if one of these messages gets missed?
So this is another nice thing about this. So if one of these messages gets missed, then what essentially happens is temporarily these two chains become out of sync. So maybe Bob sends 10 messages to Alice. So this receiving chain is 10 long, but Alice has only received two of them so far, right? And then she receives number 9. She's got to be able to work out what key decrypts that message. Well, in the message, Bob will have some information that says, I've already sent 8 messages on this chain. Alice will look at her 2 and go, well, that's not right, so I better wait. Or I can tick 7 more ticks to get to the right key and hold on to these ones in case those messages come in later. Right? So they're both going to have to be a little bit careful about which keys they delete, which keys they keep temporarily until those messages come in. But as soon as you've used a key to decrypt a message, you delete it. Right? And they get deleted immediately. And that way, it's very robust to people, you know, capturing a device or something like that.
So I know that if I use one of these apps, Signal or WhatsApp or whatever, you get these little ticks to see if something's delivered or if it's been read. How does that work with
So if you text me, you can see that I've read it, but I've not bothered responding, right? Yeah, so that's sort of an application layer thing. So what will happen is this is kind of very low level, Like we're talking just above the kind of network protocols. You've got this stuff happening and forming the encryption. Within that, the message doesn't have to contain an image or a GIF or a text message. It could contain a read receipt or a proof of delivery or something like this. And this will depend on the actual application and how they manage these messages. It really doesn't make a lot of difference. All that happens is a kind of the wrapper around these messages is going to be these Diffie-Hellman parameters and whichever message it is in these chains.
Do they use this for video as well?
They do, yeah. So the packets that get sent when you're performing end-to-end encryption in things like Signal or WhatsApp, we use the exact same protocol for that. All encryption is done this way, right? The actual, because this is just generating keys, the actual encryption will be done with something like an AAD cipher, so for example, CHAR-CHAR or AES, and that will include all the normal symmetric key cryptography stuff that makes sure that the message hasn't been tampered with and things like this.
With my video head on, I'm wondering how it all gets chunked up, you see, but maybe that's...
Yeah, that's. I mean, that's difficult for me to know without reading the code. But, you know, it's going to be small packets of normal size, just like TLS data over the internet, right? It's not going to be much different than you watching a stream of video over an encrypted internet connection at that point.
What happens if you have more than two people involved? Does it work the same?
Not quite, right? It gets a little bit messy.
That's for another video then.
Yes. You've got to train for a long time. And let's not let Steve off the hook. Right, there's Steve over here. High value of two, high value of one, whatever that means. The interesting thing about this is we're not performing a classification.
Little endian systems. So that's why we call it endianness. It all traces back to eggs of Lilliput in Gulliver's Travels.